Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor and very moving experience that I'm standing on the same podium where 70 years ago, our founding fathers of the United Nations were gathering to talk about the future of our world. Right after terrible and tragic consequences of the Second World War. January this year, last month, I participated in a, again, very moving ceremony of, at the General Assembly Hall in UN headquarters in New York, commemorating the 70th anniversary of the first General Assembly of the United Nations, where my long time, 70 years ago, the first Secretary General of the United Nations, Trygve Lie, was elected, which you have seen in the video. And I'm just excited and honored and humbled that I'm taking this torch, which have been carried out during the last 70 years by my distinguished predecessors. To be here is to be brought back to the days when the recovery from the Second World War was on the way, and when a new international organization was taking shape. Heartbreak was fresh as delegates gathered here in early 1946, February 1st, you saw it. Across the continent, cities were still filled with rubble, and families were reeling from their losses. In Britain, food was still rationed, and young men faced military conscription. But hopes were very high. 7 months earlier, in San Francisco, United States, states had adopted the United Nations Charter. 70 years ago, this week, here in this hall, the United Nations took its first tangible steps, including the appointment of Secretary General, as I said. I want to pay special tribute to one person who was in this chamber at that time. He's one of the great Britain's sons, Sir Brian Urquhart. Next to my great predecessor, Dag Hammarskjöld, no one in UN history has more embodied the ideal of global service and the principles of the Charter than Sir Brian Urquhart. In his memory, he's still living, in his tribute, I have established and named the waiting hall of the Secretary General, Sir Brian Urquhart Room. That whoever comes to see me, when they have to wait 1 minute, 2 minutes, or 5 minutes, they have to stay and think about Sir Brian Urquhart. And I really appreciate his contribution. As it happens, I spent time with Sir Brian just last week, last month, when he came to commemorate this first General Assembly meeting. He joined us at United Nations headquarters. And he's still very active, even though his health, being 96 years old, a little bit frail, but he was still very strong. His sparkle is undiminished. I bring you his greetings and his gratitude for all you are here who are doing to carry forward the work and values of the United Nations. He is with us in spirit today, and I thank you very much. And I'm also very much happy to be with amongst so many young ladies and gentlemen, and you are the hope of us. We are living in an era of peril, but the world leaders are really trying to send you and give you some good sense of hope and promises, which I'm going to discuss with you in the course of my discussions. Ladies and gentlemen, the United Nations has succeeded at the job for which it was founded, For example, to protect the succeeding generation from scourge of war. What does that mean? To prevent any other possible third world war. In that regard, I think we can be a little bit, you know, proud that we have been able to prevent that kind of a horrible and tragic world-scale war. But unfortunately, we are now seeing, and we have seen, so many crises here and there. In fact, we have helped to defeat deadly diseases, the most recently Ebola outbreak. And we have got the children in school, even though there are 60 million people, children, out of school at this time. Lift millions of out of poverty. We have at least lifted more than 100 million people, half of the abject poverty. But still, we have as many as those people still out of in extreme poverty. At the same time, we are keenly aware of our failures and setbacks. The United Kingdom has been a key partner every step of the way. You have championed human rights, international law, and agreements such as Arms Trade Treaty. I was pleased to stand with International Development Secretary Justice Greening last month in Davos Forum in announcing the establishment of United Nations' first ever high-level panel on women's economic empowerment. The United Kingdom is a leading humanitarian donor, as we saw again yesterday with your generous pledges for Syrian refugees and Syrian people under siege. And at a time when others are cutting back on development aid, Britain has ring-fenced its own vital support for the world's poorest and most vulnerable people. I really appreciate such kind of contribution and leadership of the United Kingdom. As I said, United Kingdom is no exception. You are going through very difficult financial and economic difficulties, but Prime Minister David Cameron has ring-fenced 0.7% of GDP for official development assistance. A few years ago, when I was attending G8 summit meeting, I was with the G8 leaders and with some African leaders, including the president from Korea. I particularly recognized Prime Minister David Cameron's such kind of very visionary and firm commitment to ring fence this 0.7%. Look, dear leaders, I sincerely hope that you emulate, you learn and the examples of United Kingdom. Every country is going through difficult economic situations. But UK is one of the just five countries who are keeping this promise for humanity. And yesterday, again, under the leadership of United Kingdom, co-sponsored by the Prime Ministers of Norway and Federal Chancellor Angela Merkel of Germany and Emir of Kuwait, together with the United Nations, you have shown such a great strength of solidarity for humanity, raising more than $10 billion during my limited time as a Secretary General during the last 9 years. I have never seen that United Nations has mobilized more than $10 billion in one day for one single cause for Syria. This is something which we should be very proud. Despite all acrimonious debate or whatever, fightings, then still we are showing, we have shown great humanity for our people in other parts of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, today we need UK contributions, as I said, more than ever. The world is being tested. People worry about the next extreme storm, terrorist attacks, financial shock, or outbreak of deadly disease. We are very much alarmed about Zika virus again. I have discussed this matter with the WHO Director General, Dr. Margaret Chan, in Geneva last week. And we are mobilizing all, working together with WHO and major countries who would have capacity to prevent and eradicate this Zika virus. Yet, with all this, but I'm very optimistic about our future. I take heart in part from the two landmark achievements of last year, 2015. The Sustainable Development Agenda, aiming 2030, with 17 Sustainable Development Goals, and Paris Agreement on Climate Change. These are two important visions and commitments adopted and laid out by the world leaders. They have shown sense of purpose, sense of unity, despite all political, ideological, religious differences. More than 150 world leaders came. Again, I have never seen in my life that more than 150 president and prime minister came in one place at one time in one day. That number of leaders come to United Nations over a period of 10 days during General Assembly, but not in one day. Yesterday, we have raised more than $10 billion in one day for one cause. So we have seen during over just 1 month such a great show of solidarity and leadership and vision. That is what I am asking world leaders and world citizens: show your unity of purpose. In shaping this 2030 development agenda, we ask the people around the world through My World questionnaire, using United Nations website, we've been asking, reaching out at least the 8 million people around the world, what kind of a world do you want? Just let us know. And 8 million people responded, I want this kind of world, I want this, I want that. And we all summarized and compiled and presented to the General Assembly of the United Nations. It was inclusive dialogue. It was the way we really wanted to make inclusive dialogue for a sustainable development. The Millennium Development Goals, which was adopted in 2000, generated remarkable gains. The Sustainable Development Goals, which is now abbreviated as SDGs, will take us even farther. Human rights and women's empowerment are major threats. The goals focus on good governance and are the critical factors for stability. Crucially, the new goals are universal, applying to all countries, since even the wealthiest societies have yet to fully conquer inequality or exclusion. The Paris Agreement is a further turning point. It's not the end. Some people say that, well, we have signed the agreement, that's all. It's not the beginning, but it's not the end either. It's a very important turning point in making people and our Earth onto a sustainable path where we will be able to contain the rise of global temperature below 2 degrees centigrade, or even we will strive to get it down to 1.5 degrees centigrade. Without that, we will have serious consequences affecting not only us, whole our world. If we see the people consuming and people abusing their privilege of nature. It seems that many people seem to believe that we have two planet Earth, but we have only one Earth. This is the only place where human beings can live together with nature. We cannot negotiate with nature. We have to do according to what nature goes. We cannot go against it. We cannot negotiate with nature. In that regard, Paris Agreement is a good turning point to change our way of thinking, to change our behavior, to change our course in living harmoniously with nature. The 2030 Agenda is the world's declaration of interdependence. Now, I'm telling you this interdependency of climate change agreement and sustainable development goals. We have 17 goals, which covers whole spectrums of our life and our nature. Climate change is just one of 17 goals. Number 13 goal is climate change. If we do not fully implement, and if we do not go as science tells us, then all this 16, rest of the 16 goals will be seriously undermined. Not a single goal among 17 goes in silo or in separation. They are all tightly interconnected. So all these things must have gone together, must be implemented comprehensively. Ladies and gentlemen, I have a great hope. At the same time, the world faces undeniable dangers. The savagery in Syria will soon enter its sixth year. We must continue to press for an end to the fighting, sieges, and abuses of human rights. Yemen is also in flames. Coalition airstrikes, in particular, continues to strike hospitals, schools, mosques, and civilian infrastructures. In this world, at this time, more than 125 million people need immediate humanitarian assistance. Just in an interesting way to make you remember this, if we have all these 125 million people living in one country, suppose we establish one independent country with 125 million all these poor people around the world. This will be 11th largest country in the world, only next to Japan. So how big a country this will be? We have to sustain and support all these 125 million people every day, day and night. That's a huge challenge. But with the solidarity support you have shown yesterday, I think we can do it. These numbers are unsustainable. The human costs are intolerable. I myself was once a displaced person. Some of you might have read my life story. I was born in Korea just before the end of Second World War. But when I became 6 years old, the Korean War broke out in 1950. I was just 6 years old. It was before my school, and I had to flee my home with my parents without knowing where to go. But life was miserable, terrible. But for a young boy, I couldn't feel as seriously, as terribly my parents might have felt. Most of you may not feel as I felt at the time. We survived on food and medicines, which was provided by the United Nations at the time, UNICEF. They provided all humanitarian assistance, powdered milk, and small toys even. And UNESCO provided us textbooks, notes. United Nations provided us, more importantly, their security. The United Nations, for the first time, in exercising their authority to maintain international peace and security. The Security Council has shown unity at that time. We were lucky. The Security Council adopted the resolution creating a United Nations command. 16 nations provided their soldiers, including many young men from United Kingdom, who many hundreds of United Kingdom young men died in the battlefield. They are still buried in Korea. And Korean people are really looking after all these sacrifices. Without the United Nations, I would not be able to stand before you today. If I think about all what had happened to me and to my country, to my people, and only was able to survive because of the United Nations, with the aid of the United Nations, then now I'm standing as a Secretary General. I'm feeling humbled. At that time, to me, as a young boy, the United Nations, a blue flag, was a beacon of hope. Our savers. Then I'm much more humbled than before whenever I travel around the world. I see still too many people in this world. United Nations flag, United Nations logo itself are beacons of hope. Then I have no other choice but to be motivated to render all what I have. Only regret is that I have limited resources, limited capacity as a human being. This is what I am telling you, particularly young people here. You may not appreciate all this wealth and happiness and stability as much as I or my generation people, or many people around the world who are living in a very difficult world may appreciate. Don't take it for granted. Nothing should be taken for granted for you. I'm asking you to look beyond the United Kingdom. United Kingdom is one of the most powerful, richest countries in the world. But this is not for free. This has not come free. Democracy, 900 years in this history, and all these sacrifices has built up and made you strong. Ladies and gentlemen, people these days, people still are struggling to keep their lives. People who cross Aegean seas, Mediterranean seas, or English Channel in search of better lives are symptoms, not themselves cause for suspicion or concern. We must counter those who promote dangerous myths about refugees and migrants. We must look at the roots of the conflicts and governance failures that compel people to undertake perilous journeys. Across the United Nations, we are placing greater emphasis on prevention. The Human Rights Upfront Initiative calls on us to act early in response to violations of human rights before countries reach the point of no return. The United Nations plan of action to prevent the violent extremism focuses on underlying drivers of radicalization and the need to avoid approaches that end up alienating people who are trying to reach. We are going to convene humanitarian summit meeting to address all these 125 million people who need our immediate support in Istanbul in May. We continue to advocate the responsibility to protect, especially to build up national capacities to prevent genocide and other grave violations of human rights. We have learned hard lessons, tragic lessons from the tragedies. We have seen genocide in Rwanda in 1994. We have seen genocide in Srebrenica in 1995. And we have seen the genocide in Cambodia in the 1970s. Each time, world leaders committed, never again, never again. When Holocaust happened during Second World War, people committed by establishing the United Nations, never again. But these never again has been always been muted. It happened again and happened again. That's why I'm asking the member states of the United Nations to invest more on prevention rather than countering. When you see that there is a symptom for fire, then you better address these symptoms before, rather than bringing all fire engines after fire has broken out. That's a preventive diplomacy, which I'm saying. Just jokingly saying, last month in Davos Forum, I was asked by a reporter, if I were given impossible stories, if you were given an opportunity of flying a time machine, would you like to go back to the past or would you like to go fly to the future? My answer was that, well, if I were given that opportunity, I would like to fly back to the future. Then why? As a Secretary General, I would like to go back and try to find out what had gone wrong. Could we have been able to prevent had we taken some measures properly? Could we have been able to prevent such kind of a genocide and tragedies? That will be great lessons. Then I'll go forward. I'd like to see how people will remember my legacy as a Secretary General and what kind of world my great children would be living in. I think I might have been too much ambitious, but that was my pure and genuine feeling as a Secretary General. So let us look back. What have you done wrong? What could you have done better to prevent something which might happen or have already happened? United Nations looks to states such as, therefore, many member states like United Kingdom for leadership across all the agenda which I have presented. Preventing extremism and promoting human rights go hand in hand. And we look to you to set a positive example by upholding these hard-won gains abroad and at home. I commend the United Kingdom for its role in the landmark deal between Iran and the P5+1 countries on Iran's nuclear programs. We must show the same determination in resolving conflicts in the region. In both Syria and Yemen, the United Nations is doing all it can to get a dialogue started between warring parties. Sectarian tensions and regional power struggles are proving hard to surmount. There is no military solution. That's what I've been saying. Even this morning, I talked to a reporter, there is no military solution. Only through inclusive political dialogue can we solve all these seemingly intractable, complicated situations. We need states that are party to arms trade treaty to set an example in fulfilling one of the treaty's main purposes, controlling arms flows to actors, then may use them in ways that breach international humanitarian law. As a permanent member of the Security Council, the United Kingdom has a key role and key voice in establishing and guiding UN peace operations. The UK has recently pledged support for peacekeeping in South Sudan and Somalia. We hope you will go beyond those engagements and provide even more troops to places where they need your support. Baroness Annalee, Sir Jeremy, Lord Williams, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, UN Association are among our most important allies. They bring UN ideals and objectives into their communities and local concerns into the world arena. I welcome your special commitment to mobilize new generations of UN supporters, empowering young people and women is one of my top priorities. I have made women empowerment as one of my top priorities, and I have next time you come to the United Nations, my conference hall, you will see almost a half of women senior advisors sitting around me, around the table. There were very few. You may remember that Dame Margaret Anstey, who wrote the very famous memoir, Never to Learn Type. At that time, the four ladies, women, the maximum position you may expect was secretaries, to become secretaries. So you have to know how to type. She gave me a book titled, Never to Learn to Type. That was quite inspiring, moving. I met her a few years ago. She was the first woman under Secretary General. We have Ambassador John Holmes, who was under Secretary General for Humanitarian Affairs. But we have so many men, male under Secretary General, but not many women. At that time, she was the only one, first ever in the history of the UN. Then I have appointed, I do not know how many, maybe 50, 60, depending upon this double appointment, who has moved from here to another, more than 100 appointment women. They are all women, Assistant Secretary General or Under Secretary General. I have changed the whole landscape. I have to do more for youth, unfortunately. But it was I who appointed for the first time the Special Envoy on Youth. There was no such title. Now he's working very hard to promote the future of young people. But I'm always happy to work with young people. I know there are voices that question greater role of the United Nations. I'm conscious of the criticism and expectations in a good sense about the United Nations. Can you do better? Can you do more efficiently, more effectively, more accountably, more transparent way? I'm very much conscious. We are now doing a great work to change United Nations to meet the expectation, to be able to deliver what member state and charter ask us to serve the people, we the peoples. The distinction between national and international benefit and interest are falling away. There is no such boundaries that keeps people only in one place. This world may be small, but still there are so many things to do. It's still wide. I see a new understanding emerging which grasps global logic of our times and which agrees the British traditions are best sustained and British interests are best pursued through full engagement with the world and with the United Nations. We face great challenges, that's true, but our capacity to solve them even greater. We have unlimited capacity if we are united, if we are one, if we work together, and we can build this world better for all. Let's work together, ladies and gentlemen, to make this world better, where nobody is left behind. Thank you for your commitment and leadership. Thank you.